Hey, good morning, church. And stand, if you will, as we sing Our God. Water you turned into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. None like you. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. No one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, and if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God.
Join me in prayer. Our Father, you are awesome in this place. We welcome you to come into this service and take charge of every aspect of our worship. We ask that the Holy Spirit would fill this room. We pray that you would minister to the hearts of many who are hurting, some who are dealing with loneliness, some with depression. Some are worried about the days ahead, maybe their finances. Some are dealing with physical ailments and sickness. Some have lost precious loved ones and are grieving. Please take note of your needy people this day. And you said you'd meet all of our needs according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. We trust you to minister today to the needs of your people. We ask that you would help us to proclaim your truth clearly with liberty, and that we would receive the truth as we worship this morning, and that we would go out to live the truth. We love you. We have found you faithful. We find no fault in you. And we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Let me extend a welcome to all of you who are worshiping with us by live stream today. It is a delight to have many who do just that. And we hope that our service will be a blessing to you wherever you are and whatever's going on in your life. God loves you. You're special to Him. And we're also grateful for those who are here today. I couldn't help but notice the floral arrangement in front of the pulpit. It just captivated me when I walked into the room. It is so bright with color and it's beautiful. And then I thought, Lord, how beautiful that is. And I've been around shaking hands and speaking to many of you. And then I said, but as pretty as it is, it's not as beautiful as your people in God's house today. It is a delight to have you today. Would you allow me to share some words of announcement that are important? Especially, I want to remind our youth that this evening I'm going to have a party for you. We're calling it Pizza with the Pastor. We're going to play some games. I'm going to give away some gifts. And I'm talking about some nice gifts here. I'm not going to be El Cheapo Pastor tonight. We're going to have fun, and some folks are going to leave here smiling bigger than others, but all will leave smiling. It's going to be a great evening. It'll start after our evening worship service. I encourage the youth to come and be my guest and sit in the center section tonight. And I'm going to bring a message tonight entitled, Better Together. Better Together. And so don't miss that message tonight. And I hope there's some principles in that message that our youth will capture and remember throughout their lives, and all of us will benefit from. Let me tell you, there's a lot of work going on in our church now by a lot of committees and teams of ministry. Our nominating committee is trying to fill important positions in our church. This is a critical work. It's an important work. And we want the right people in the right place to help serve the people of God at First Baptist Coushatta and the Lord. We are needing a little help. First of all, the Bible says that if you need laborers in the harvest, pray, and that God will send forth laborers into the harvest. And our nominating committee and this pastor and others, we've been praying that God would touch some hearts to step forward and fill a few vacancies we have. Let me just mention three in particular we're praying over. And would you think about maybe that God could use you in one of these places? We are needing a children's one Sunday school teacher. That's first to third grade age. That's so important. And we need someone to fill that gap. We're needing a volunteer for preschool church. And you say, I'm not sure what that's all about. We'll help you know what that's about if you'll just step forward and say, tell me more. And then an area where most churches struggle that are our size, we need a college and career Sunday school teacher. A college and career Sunday school teacher. I want to ask you, all of you, would you pray and say, Lord, is there a vacancy there that I might could step up and fill next year in our church? I'll need you to help me, Lord. We all do. Some of the best experiences of my life is when I stepped forward in faith and took on something that was out of my comfort zone. And I want to ask you to think about this. We have a sheet out here as you leave the service this morning on the table there that you can just sign your name saying, I'm interested in knowing more about that. I might help with that. Could we hear from you today? Don't let this go in one ear out the other. Please take, if I take time in a worship service to emphasize this, you can know that this is important. So a children's one teacher, volunteer for preschool, and a college and career Sunday school teacher. And if you want to know more, you can talk with some on the nominating committee, Penny Hayes, Steve Stroud, among others, or talk to me. We need your help. And then let me just remind you that the memorial service for Randy Mosley is going to be this coming Saturday at 2 o'clock here in our church. There will be a visitation time following the service with some refreshments. So remember that. It's coming up this Saturday, and I hope you'll keep the family in mind, pray for them, and if possible, come show your respect. Hey, we're going to continue to worship. We appreciate our musicians, those who are helping us today. Be praying for the message. Open your mind. Open your heart. God is wanting to speak to all of us this day. Thank you for coming.
And shake hands with those around you this morning. Welcome each other. And several people have come in throughout the morning. So Let them know you're welcome this morning. As you're returning to your seats, you can join me as we sing "The Old Rugged Cross." You can be seated.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love
I worship you. Father, thank you so much for today, and just thank you for allowing us to come here of our own free will, Lord, and worship you, Lord. I just ask that you take these tithes and offerings, Lord. We just lift them up to you, and we just ask that you give us the guidance to use it in your will, Lord. Forgive us in the many ways we fail you. Amen.
His hands, his feet, my sin. Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore.
I direct your attention this morning to two passages of Scripture that will be the main texts. I will be referring in my message to many other Scriptures along the way. First, from the Old Testament, Malachi chapter 3, verse 8 through 10. Malachi 3, 8 through 10. Will a man rob God? Yet you've robbed me. But you say, wherein have we robbed thee? In tithes and offerings. You're cursed with a curse, for you've robbed me, even this whole nation. Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house, and prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, If I will not open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. And then in the New Testament, if you would listen as I read and follow in your Bible, if you choose, 1 Corinthians 16, verse 2. 1 Corinthians 16, verse 2. Upon the first day of the week, let everyone, not a few, not some, let every one of you lay by him in store, as God has prospered him, that there be no gathering when I come. A casual reading of Scripture reveals that Jesus Christ had a lot to say about our relationship to material things. He said words like, where your heart is, there will your treasure be also. He said, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. Material things. He said, lay not up for yourselves treasures upon the earth, but lay up treasures in heaven. That's just a small sampling of statements that Jesus uttered. He spoke often about our relationship to material things and our money. If the Lord was very vocal about money and material things, why should His people be silent about such things? It is clear, undisputed, that our Lord expects us to give, to be givers. When you read the Bible, the Sermon on the Mount outlines some of our Christian duties and responsibilities. And the Lord did not say in the Sermon on the Mount, if you decide to pray. He said, when you pray, enter your closet. In the Sermon on the Mount, he did not say, if you decide to fast. He didn't say if. He said, when you fast, do so with a happy face. He didn't say, if you decide to give a little to help my kingdom work. No, he said, when you do give, do it for the glory of God and not for the praise of men. It is not a matter of if you give, child of God. It's a matter of when. The Lord expected we'd be givers. He didn't say if. He expected that we'd be giving people. And in Matthew 23, 28, Jesus spoke to the people of His day who were big on tithing. And He said, you ought to be doing that. That was His position on tithing. Nothing wrong with that. You ought to do it, He said. And so, realizing that our Savior expects us to be a giving people, let me explore with you the subject of God's plan for kingdom finance. I didn't say my plan or some TV evangelist plan. I said God's plan for kingdom finance. I read to you from Malachi and then from the Corinthian epistle. In both of those, we realize that God has always, for His people in the Old Testament and the New Testament, given guidelines for giving. Giving is not left up to just your whim and how you want to go about giving, having your little private little money puddle over here that you decide what you'll give to. No. God's got a plan. He does things decently and in order, and that's so even in the realm of stewardship. And so I'm going to say to you that You should be giving. If you're not, you're going to miss a blessing. I've preached all of my ministry without apology. It is more blessed to give than to receive. Why should we be givers? Because I think the Bible gives us guidelines in that direction. I particularly focus in on the word tithing. I don't apologize for that. I'm a tither. I believe tithing is for us today in the sense that it's the minimum beginning point. A tithe was one-tenth of one's increase. One-tenth of one's increase. And that, in the Old Testament, is to me, that's just the beginning. That's where you start, and hopefully we grow in the grace of giving. I do not say this for selfish reasons or to pat myself on the back. I'm ashamed I haven't grown more in the area of giving. But for a number of years, I decided with my wife that we'd put God to the test. And for over 6 years of our lives, we double tithed. That don't make anything special out of me. Don't make me better than anybody. I just decided that you can't outgive God. I never went hungry. I didn't get to buy a new car as often as I'd like. But I had good transportation. What I'm preaching this morning is not something I'm just throwing at you. I've put God to the test. And I've learned some things about giving through the years that I gladly share with others. And I think you should consider tithing if you don't tithe, because it meets the guidelines of giving in the New Testament and the Old. God always has a plan for proportionate giving. As you have prospered, he said in the New Testament. Give a proportion of how I've prospered you. In the Old Testament, bring the tithe, a portion, 10%. God has always asked for a proportion of what he's blessed you with. And not only has he asked for a specific consideration of what you'll give, but he's directed you to bring it at a special time. In the New Testament, on the first day of the week, when you come together, what did they come together to do? To worship. He said, on that day, come bring that offering out of what I've prospered you with. So he had a place, he had a time, he had a proportion. That is Old Testament and that is New Testament. And we'll answer the question in a minute whether tithing is just for Old Testament people. But for right now, I want to tell you all to tithe because it meets biblical guidelines. And when you obey God in the matter of giving, you'll be blessed. Obedience always brings blessings. You can't get around that. Now let me give you some practical reasons why you ought to try tithing if you don't. Tithing honors God. The Bible says in Proverbs 3:9, honor the Lord with your substance. So giving honors God. Tithe giving will do wonders for the work of God. Many churches could launch out into more ministries and do more things if the people were faithful in giving. They'd have the resources. The Bible says, bring the tithe in that there may be meat in my house so that the needs of my kingdom's work will be met. So tithe giving will do wonders for the work of God. Tithe giving will bring blessings to you. Now, I'm not some TV evangelist up here saying, send me this money, I'll send you this, that, and the other. Or if you will give, God will put a new Rolls Royce in your driveway and you'll get rich. I'm not a health and wealth preacher. I just know that if you honor God with what He's blessed you with, there will be blessings that come from that. They may not be material. There may be other blessings, or they may be material. I have learned that God can do more with my 90% than I can do with 100% if I don't give Him anything. I believe that with all my heart. It's a mystery. It's a miracle. Have you give God what's His, what's left over, He'll help you manage it better. And He has a mysterious, miraculous way of blessing that 90% so that you get further down the road than you would have with your 100%. I've put Him to the test. I know this works. And I'll tell you, tithe giving will guard your heart from becoming greedy. When you learn to turn loose and give and give and give, you will be surprised how your life will be better. You know, I'm going to carry people to Israel here in about 1 month. And we'll sail on the Sea of Galilee, and it's vibrant with fish and marine life, and it's amazing. We'll stop in the middle of the Sea of Galilee and have a worship service. I'll also take them to the lowest part on earth, the Dead Sea. And some of them are going to swim in the Dead Sea. Well, they're going to float. The Dead Sea has no living stuff in it. It has no outlet. It doesn't give off. It's sterile. It's dead. Full of these old salty minerals that kill things. The Sea of Galilee, from the Mount Hermon, it has the waters rushing down into the sea, feeding it, and it's giving off in the Jordan River. And as it gives off, there's a flow. You get it, and you give it, and there's life. And it's that way in our spiritual lives. When God gives us material money like that, if we take it and we pass some on as He's directed, it makes us healthier. It makes life better. And I think tithe giving frees us from greed and avarice and what that can do to a person's life. I think we ought to tithe because it promotes thrift. Now, I'm not the smartest guy that ever came out of Alabama or Mobile or Satsuma. But I got enough sense to know that if I give up at least 10% of what my increase is going to be, I'm going to have to be a little better manager of that 90%. I need to watch my economies a little bit. Tithe giving can promote thrift, and you'll become a better manager as you seek to use that 90%, and then God gets in that 90%. So I want to tell you that I believe tithe giving promotes faith. You begin to trust God to take care of you with 90% instead of the 100%. I think tithe giving is the best way you can prove the sincerity of your love for the Lord. Paul wrote to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians 8:8, and he said, "Prove the sincerity of your love." And that's in the context of giving. Read your Bible. He's saying, you can prove how much you love the Lord if you're giving to Him. I have seen that bumper sticker. You have too. You've passed it before. Somebody will have a bumper sticker and it says, "Honk if you love Jesus." I wish we'd come up with a bumper sticker that says, "Tithe if you love Jesus." Because we can prove the sincerity of our love by what we do with our pocketbook. And so I'm here today to encourage you to be a giver and to consider being at least a tither, the starting point, the 10%. Now, let me tell you why I think some of us don't tithe, why people don't tithe. Some don't tithe because they haven't been taught to tithe. They've sat under the ministry of a pastor or some Sunday school teacher that never goes there. I get concerned when there are those who are teachers and preachers who water down the lordship of Jesus. Jesus is to be Lord over everything in my life, even my pocketbook. And those who water that down do you no service. It is a great deprivation for you not to be taught to bring God into your finances. You'll be the loser. I remember when I was a young boy, my first real job, I was a newspaper delivery boy for the Mobile Press Register. And I was about 12 when I got that job. My uncle, he was responsible for hiring all the local boys in different areas. He worked for the paper. And he gave me the job. I wanted that job so bad. And I remember, I think the first time I got money, I collected money. You deliver the papers and then you collect a little later. I don't think it was a whole month. I think my first month, I was just on the job 3 weeks, so I didn't get a full month. But the best I remember back then, and this was a lot of money for a 12-year-old boy, I think I cleared $17. It was right about that. And I remember bringing it in. I laid it on the bed, and I had my quarters over here, and my dimes and my nickels, and I had some dollars and stuff like that. I had it all broken down, and my mother came in. She said, "Son, God's blessed you, and I'm proud of your work." And she reached over, and she said, "Now, son," and I don't know exact amount, but I'm thinking something like $17. She moved a few quarters over and some ones, and she put a, it was a, if it was 17, it was $1.70. She said, "Now, son, the Lord wants you to honor him with part of what he's blessed you with." I didn't have any problem with that. I was so happy. God gave me that job. I was glad to give that $1.70. There were about 6 other boys wanting that job, and God let me get it. And so I started, that's how I started tithing. I was taught as boy, some are never taught. Tithing is not something you just learn by osmosis. You have to be taught and guided in that direction. And I'm glad I went to a church that was a Bible teaching church that taught tithing. And the preachers were not scared to mention money. You know, I remember I pastored Summer Grove Baptist Church in Shreveport for right at 15 years. I've gone back through the years and looked at my preaching ministry there because I manuscript all my messages. I have a record of what I preached, where I used it, and when. And if I deal with that text again, I know how I used it in the past, and I may massage and see other things now and see things I didn't see before. But I kind of went back, and you know what I discovered about my preaching on money? I averaged 1 sermon a year. I had 14 or 15 stewardship sermons. Nobody could honestly say every time I go to Summer Grove Baptist Church, all that preacher talks about is money. I only preach once a year, honey. I'm really not proud of that. I wish I'd have talked about it a little more than that. We ought to teach our people. And I'm sure in our Bible study lessons, Sunday school, what have you, it was going out and our church believed that. But I never overdid it. And our people, when people are right with God, it's kind of easy to get them to loosen their money. But if they're not really sold out to His Lordship, it's kind of hard. So some don't tithe because they've never been taught. And I would say to any preacher, teach giving. Systematic, regular, proportionate giving that will match up with Scripture, old and new. Teach it regularly, teach it firmly, teach it clearly and unapologetically. Another reason people don't tithe is because of a misunderstanding between law and grace. Some say, "Brother Wayne, that 10% of the increase, that's under the law. We're not under the law anymore." Well, you got it wrong. You're not rightly dividing the word of truth. Tithing was around before the law. Abraham tithed before Moses ever came on the scene to give us the law. Abraham tithed before the law. Jacob continued that practice before the law. Moses came. Now notice, Abraham commenced it. Jacob continued it. Moses commanded it. And Jesus commended it. So don't try to get around it. Even after the law, Jesus said you ought to be at least a tither. So don't get confused about that and try to do away with tithing because, oh, that's under the law and that's the way I can get out from under. No. If you know your Bible, you know that if Jesus did anything with the law, He always changed it upwardly, not downwardly. And I love what Adrian Rogers said. I want to quote this to you exactly. What he said in talking about tithing and so forth. He said, quote, "Any Christian who will let an Old Testament Jew do more under the law in giving than he will do himself under grace is a disgrace to grace." How dare us let somebody under the law give more, 10%, than we would give today? We're under grace. And the Lord always, if He changed anything, He changed it upwardly. He said, the law says don't commit adultery, but I say don't even look on a woman to lust after. He made the law even a little stricter and better. He said, the law says don't kill, but I tell you don't hate. Let's go back to the root cause. He's always improving the law, not putting down the moral law of God. Now, the ceremonial law is another thing. That passed away with the death, burial, resurrection of Christ. But we're talking about the moral law of God. Keep the Bible straight in its context. So people don't give because they hadn't been taught. Or maybe they confused the Old Testament law with and say, we're under grace, we don't need to do that. No, in the New Testament, you're still taught to be regular giving, proportionate giving, and bring it to a certain place on the Lord's Day, which can be none other than the church. Some don't tithe because of greed. O.S. Hawkins put it this way, the principal hindrance to advancing the kingdom of God is greed. When the back of greed is broken in a Christian, God's work will prosper. I like what O.S. Hawkins said about that. Let me just mention a few other things. There's always this discussion, should I tithe on the gross or the net? I believe that you ought to tithe on the gross. 10% of your gross salary before. You know, some people say, I'm going to tithe on the net after all my deductions are taken out by my employer and everything. What's left over, I'll tithe on that. Now, I'm not going to break fellowship with you over that. But I'm going to tell you, you're missing out. You're missing a blessing. Please remember that what's been deducted from your check is a benefit to you. I'm living now with some Social Security money that I had to pay all those years. In my retirement years, it helps. What I was paying out, taken out of my increase at that time, is a benefit now. I drive on highways. My taxes are supposed to provide highways and stuff like that. Now, they're rough, and we need to do better. But I like it better than that old red clay road I used to drive on back in Alabama. I like them paved highways. I'm glad we got a military. They could defend us and so forth. What I'm saying is, a lot of what comes out and we get to that net is for your benefit too. And a tithe is a tenth of your increase. That's an increase. That's a blessing. And we need to remember that. And as you make that decision, don't forget that deductions are an increase for you. And if you spend too much time arguing about gross versus net, that sort of borders on giving begrudgingly. Be careful. If you err on the side of generosity, you can't outgive God. You know, some have said to me through the years, I've pastored some very wealthy people and some very poor people. And some have wondered, I just make so little money. It's not going to make much difference. My tithe's not going to make much difference at the church. They'll get by without it. Should I tithe, brother, on this little bit? My mother finished the years of her life on a very small Social Security check. I call it slow security check. And then I would help her get a car and I would help her with other expenses. She had a limited income. But I'm going to tell you the first thing she did, that sweet little lady with that little hand would write her check out to the Lord. Mark 12, 41 through 44 talks about the lady who gave the widow's mite. She showed up and put 2 pence in the offering that day. She gave after all the rich people came by and put their big amounts in. Thank God for wealthy people who are blessed, who honor God with what they have. We don't put that down. But she came and put her little 2 pence in there. And Jesus told his disciples, he said, you saw what I saw. The rich people gave, she gave. He said, she was the best giver today. And he praised her giving. The widow's mite, he praised it. He said, she has given all she had. She gave all she had at that time. What she had, she gave it all. And he praised that. So It's important you realize tithing's for the rich and the poor. It is very, very, very important. Whether you're rich or poor, the tithe is the Lord's. Some people say, Brother Wayne, can't I send some of my tithe to ministries that uphold the Word of God besides the local church? I like this TV preacher. I've got some TV preachers. I love Charles Stanley and Jeremiah out there in California, David Jeremiah. I got my favorite preachers. I didn't have a problem with giving to them. And for years, I supported parachurch groups. Still do. Campus Crusades, one of the greatest ministries I've ever heard of. Navigators. The Wycliffe Bible Society. I used to every year give every month to them, translating scriptures in different languages. But it never came out of my tithe. It came out of my offerings. And we're to be giving tithes and offerings. I believe the tithe is to come to the local church. And I believe that strongly. That doesn't mean you can't send money to other ministries. But I believe in storehouse tithing. You know, he said, on the first day of the week, you bring it. To where? The church. If the local church is not the storehouse today, pray tell me what is. Pray tell me what is. You can't. And in Acts 4, 34 through 35, they took the monies the people given, they brought it into the leadership of the church, and the leadership of the church determined how it would be spent. Now this is important. Please hear me this morning. When you bring the tithe into the storehouse, you're saying this is God's money, and I don't have a right to tell Him how He should spend it. When you designate your tithes, you're saying, God, I know this is yours because the tithe is the Lord's. And it's holy unto God. And when you designate tithe, you're telling God how to spend His money. When you bring it to the storehouse, spiritual people collectively, that money is taken and they pray over how it will be dispersed in the form of our church budget. And if you leave it to individuals to decide how to spend God's money, here's what you get. You get confusion. You see, I might want them to take my tithe and really spend it on the young people because I have a real love for young people. Some of you may say, hey, I think senior adults ought to get more. You're going to give most of your money to senior adults. I love the children. Children's ministry ought to get more. And on we could go saying, oh, I don't think we ought to support this college up here, whatever, Baptist schools and things like that. We have a narrow vision. But when we bring our tithe to the storehouse and spiritual godly people that we have chosen, they decide how we're going to distribute the money. The New Testament says that's the way it was done. Acts 4, 34 through 35. It became the central distribution point, the local church. And the wisdom of many people went into how this money should be spent on the many needs in the kingdom, not just the few we might focus in on. And others would go starving if it was all there for us to decide. So I believe in bringing that money to the central storehouse, the church, and let the church be the distribution point. And I'm not saying you can't give to other things outside. That's where your offerings come in. You know, I think about the fellow who is called in your Bible the Good Samaritan. He comes along the road and he finds a man wounded, beaten, bleeding. He didn't say, yeah, I'm going to help him, but I got to run to the temple and get them to cut a check. That's not what he said. He helped him out of his resources. And that's what we do with our offerings. We help people out of our resources. We bring our tithe into the storehouse. Now that's something you may have to pray over. You may have to decide about. But the tithe's the Lord's. And you're not supposed to have your little pocket where you tell Him how to spend it. Let's trust the wisdom of a group of people looking at the big picture, not our narrow personal interest that we would support. It's healthy for the church. You know, you may say, Brother Wayne, you don't know my finances. I don't. You don't know how tough it is. Brother Wayne, I just can't afford to tithe. I would say to you with a smile on my face, patting you on the back, loving on you, saying, I don't think you can afford not to tithe. We're living in a day when inflation's going out of the roof, when things are tight for a lot of us. Hey, if we ever needed to bring God into our finances, it's now. And I'm telling you, don't ever say, well, I don't think I can afford to. Can a man afford to rob God? That's what the Bible says we're doing when we take His money and we don't distribute it the way He wants us to. I like that time-honored procedure. If you make $5,000 a month, that'll be my illustration point. You designate $500 of that money as your tithe, and you give it, whether you're paid twice a month, give it every 2 weeks, or if you paid weekly, give on it weekly. If you have a business and you don't know exactly what you're going to make this year, then sit down and pray over it and estimate what you might make this year. And you can tithe regularly on your estimate. And then you get to the end of the year, if you need to adjust it where you give more, or if you need to hold back a little bit next year because you overgave, if that's what you want to do, you're trying to be a regular, consistent giver in that situation. And so I would say you bring it, that $500, give it, and you plan your budget out of that other leftover. $4,500 would be your budget money of how you're going to live, and plan a budget and live within that budget and honor God with your money. That is a procedure. Now, it may take you a while to get there. Some of you here today are hearing me, and you may get frustrated. Maybe you say, bro, and I just can't give 10% right now. Okay. If I can get you just moving in the direction, that's better than staying where you are. I'd love for you. My daddy, I came home from college, my first year in college, for Thanksgiving dinner. Our family hosted the whole Gearhart Dubose clan. I've got German on one side of my family and French on the other. And every Christmas, everybody came to the Dubose household. And I'm not exaggerating, there would be 7 or 8 cakes, all of them made by my dad. He was a great cake baker. There'd be that many pies, Mama made the pies. Nobody brought anything in. There'd be turkeys and hams. All the trimmings. It was our annual feast. We didn't cut any corner. My first year I came home from college, I walked in getting ready for Thanksgiving. And it was unreal. Had a couple of cakes on the menu, a couple of pies, one turkey, one ham, some vegetables. Nothing like what I grew up in. I said, Mama, we're not going to have people coming this year? She said, everybody's coming. She said, your daddy got under conviction at church that he had been taking God's money and hadn't been tithing for years. And he told me, we sat down and prayed. He said, I'm going to start giving God His tenth off the top. I'm going to trust Him to take care of the rest. That's how my daddy started. And that year, we didn't have that big feast that we're accustomed to. But you know, it came back in time where we did. That's how my daddy started. Cold turkey, if you please. I'm on right now. You say, well, what about those back ties? He couldn't pay back ties. You just got to put that under the blood and ask God to forgive you. Start where you are today. And if you can't make the decision my dad made, I'm going to start giving the full 10% right now. Then find a place to start, you and God, and say, God, as you help me, I want to move to that 10%. I'm not trying to force you to do anything. I'm trying to help you grow in the grace of giving and get where God wants you to be. There's so much I'd like to say. My time is out. So let me just ask this question. How cheap are you? Why did I ask you that question? One day I was reading the newspaper years ago when I read newspapers, and it caught me an article that said, how cheap are you? The Oakland Tribune had ran a how cheap are you contest to see who was the biggest cheap person, skinflint. And they were reporting on the contest. And these people wrote in telling about their money-saving ideas. Top honors went to a retired welder. He was chosen the number one tightwad. The way he saved money was he separated 2-ply toilet paper. Oh, my soul. That's horrible. I wouldn't want to go to his house. And then there was another couple that tried to win the How Cheap Are You contest. They said that they would save and reuse dental floss. Gross. Gross. Don't do that. There's got to be a better way to save money. One man kind of flippantly said, I save 2-for-1 eating coupons. You go out and 2 eat for 1. And then I take one of my buddies out to eat. He said, they don't have to know all my business. They think I'm buying their meal. I said, I just pay for mine, pay for theirs with the coupon, never tell them different. He said, that's how I save money. That's kind of tacky to me. One man said he had a paper bag and he had to park downtown every day when he went to work. He'd put that paper bag over the parking meter and it had big letters, out of order, like the meter was out. That's how he said he saved money. That's dishonest. I don't know how you save money. I hope you're not a tightwad, a skinflint when it comes to God, that you're cheap. The Bible says God loves a cheerful giver and a generous giver. The Scripture is very clear. And I think this is where I need to close today on God loving a cheerful giver and a generous giver. You know, in 11 days, I'll have another wedding anniversary with sweet Ms. Linda. What would happen, you think, if I came home on our anniversary and I threw a brown paper sack in her lap and I said, well, here's your anniversary gift. It costs too much. I know you're going to gripe about it. I didn't get you something real nice, but there it is. Now, wouldn't that bless her, old grumpy giver? On the other hand, if I buy a thoughtful gift, wrap it in something real nice, put a little sweet note in it, darling, you deserve so much more than this. When I get more resources, I promise you I will do better. It'll mean something to her the way I gave it. Not begrudgingly. My wife hates it when the Girl Scout cookies come out. We go to Walmart or something, those little sweet Girl Scouts are there selling their cookies. She knows me. I'm a sucker. I love cookies. Now let's just suppose I went up there and this little girl's at the door. I can't get by her. She's right there. And she's wanting me to buy cookies. And let's just suppose I said, not you Girl Scouts again. Is it that time of the year? Y'all always want me to buy something. I guess I will. But you know, y'all charge too much for those cookies. And they're not all that good. Well, here you are. I'll take half a box. What do you mean you don't break the box? What a ripoff. And that little girl feels rotten, and I'm buying that little cookie thing, the way I did it was bad. But suppose, and this is what I love to do, walk up and say, oh, is it Girl Scout cookie time again? I love this time of the year. I'm so glad y'all are out here. I love those cookies. You mean they're only $5 for 2 cookies? That is awesome. I love that. Give me 5 boxes. You know what? That little girl's smiling when I walk away. And she's putting her money in her little box. And I'll carry those cookies home and enjoy them for a while. The way you give is important. God loves a cheerful giver, not a grudging giver. I got to get that money in down at the church. You know, and the Lord loves generous givers, not tightwads. He wants you to be generous. Those who sow sparingly reap sparingly. You give a little, you get a little. But those who sow bountifully, my Bible says, will be blessed bountifully. I came here today knowing where we are as a church. Our church is blessed. Many of you are wonderful givers. You really are. And this is probably my one stewardship sermon for the year. But I wanted to challenge all of us to keep God in our finances or bring Him in if we need to. Try the tithe if you haven't. Prove the Lord. I've put Him to the test. And you can't outgive Him. Father, use this message to encourage Your children to honor You with what You've blessed them with. And remind us anew and afresh that it is more blessed to give than to receive. Lord, meet the needs of our church. We got plans in the future. A lot of big things coming up down the road. We trust You to take care of us and use Your people to do so. In Jesus' name, amen. Those Macedonians gave, Paul said, they gave out of their poverty. They didn't have a lot. But Paul said about those Macedonians and their giving. He said, don't miss this, they first gave themselves and then they gave their money. If you're here today and you've never given your heart to Christ, given yourself to Him, that comes before giving your pocketbook to Him. You need Christ, come and let me pray with you and give your heart to Him. Let's stand, let's sing. Dr. Hunter, you lead us.
Oh, soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Church, I hope you have a good afternoon. Remember our service tonight. Youth, we want you to kind of sit in this section. And then we're going to go have the pastor's party. I'm looking forward to it. I can't wait. I'm excited. And I think we'll have a good time together. Preaching tonight on Better Together. Better Together. Don't miss that sermon. And I hope you have a great afternoon. Dr. Hunter, you close us if you feel led.
Let's pray. Father, we just come to You again, and Lord, thank You for the many ways that You've poured out Your blessings on us and help us to be faithful with what You have blessed us with and help us to bless others with it and grow Your kingdom. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.